In late 1967, when I was in fifth grade, a neighbor of mine gave me a portable radio that she and her husband were no longer using. It was a very 1960s looking radio, sort of a green and I think gold plastic scheme. The radio had two bands. One of them was AM, and the other one was marked SW, which I didn't know what was. Unlike most of the portable radios of this time, this one did have a telescoping antenna, which you usually would only see on an AM-FM radio, so I assumed that the other band was supposed to be FM. But if that's what it was, it surely didn't work right, because as I tuned around on this SW band, I picked up some strange stations, the first of which was this. In these days, radio and TV stations were not on the air 24 hours a day, and they would often play a tone when they were about to come on the air. So I interpreted these beeps as some station about to sign on. So I waited. And eventually,
CHU, Canada, Eastern Standard Time, 14 hours, 46 minutes.
14 heures, 46 minutes.
To my surprise, right after identifying and giving the time in English and French, it went right back to beeping, which it kept doing for about another minute, until
CHU, Canada, heure normale de l'Est, 14 heures, 47 minutes.
14 hours. 47 minutes.
The odd-numbered minutes had the French guy announcing first, and at the top of the hour, he got a long tone plus an extra period of silence. And that's what the whole station did. I'd never heard of anything like this before. I was living in the New York City area at this time, and this station came in pretty well during the daytime on what turned out to be 7.335 megahertz. At night, it was also audible, but conditions were different. There were other stations interfering with this one, and it was a lot noisier overall.
CHU, Canada, Eastern Standard Time, 19 hours, 56 minutes.
19 heures, 56 minutes.
The first interfering station that I heard clearly was this one. Now this whole thing was starting to strike me as a little bit strange. We've got one station that just beeps and announces the time, and this other station spent 4 minutes playing that same musical phrase over and over. And that wasn't the only station that did this. A short distance away, closer to 7 megahertz, I found this. On this SW band, you could usually count on a cacophony of weird noises anytime you needed it, especially at night.
Thank you.
What do you know? Another station that plays trumpets over and over. Oh well, that explains it. It's Tule Surgeon. And sometimes I'd hear things that to my inexperienced ears seemed like pure insanity. Well, at some point, fairly early on, I was talking to another kid in the neighborhood, slightly older than me, and he said, that second band on your radio isn't supposed to be FM. It's shortwave. At first, I didn't believe him, but then, yeah, I guess it is, which could explain how I'm picking up a station in Canada in the daytime. In New York, you could pick up Canadian stations at night in the AM band, but not in the daytime. And as I soon learned, on shortwave, stations from Europe would come in very strongly, in the middle frequencies between 6 and 12 megahertz, every night. One night I heard this music box and kept listening, and it turned out this station was going to speak English, at least at this time.
We begin our transmission in English with a Swiss watch giving you the exact time. At the last signal, it will be 8:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 1:30 hours Greenwich Mean Time. This is the overseas service of the Swiss Broadcasting Corporation calling from Bern, Switzerland.
Another daily program in English from SBC. But before I tell you what we're hearing, you're listening this Sunday, let me just give you the frequencies and wavelengths. 9,535 kHz, 31.46 meters. 11,715 kHz, 25.61 meters. And 15,305 kHz, 19.60 meters.
The trumpet fanfare and that little march were a little bit, I don't know, hokey, stilted, something like that. But they changed that in the early 70s and became a little more hip. The Swiss watch was replaced by a Swiss chronometer, but it still had the same six beeps.
Here is a Swiss chronometer to give you the exact time. At the last turn, it will be 11 hours Greenwich Mean Time. This is Switzerland. We're broadcasting to Africa in the 19, 16, and 13 meter bands, and to other parts of the world in the 75, 49, and 31 meter bands. Stay tuned for Dateline.
Swiss voters, yes, but Swiss cantons, no. And by the rules of the Swiss Constitution, that isn't good enough to have a suggested change accepted in this country. So the proposed article on education reform in Switzerland was defeated during the weekend. In this edition of Dateline Tuesday, we'll hear what the Swiss press has to say about this defeat.
Another station I found early on was
Radio 7, Stockholm. We broadcast in English 11 times a day, and our next transmission in English to Europe will be at 1600 hours GMT on 6065 kilohertz, 49.46 meters. And to Eastern North America at 1400 hours GMT, also on 15,315 kilohertz, 19.59 meters. Now follows a program in French.
Dies das Programm ist Sveriges Radio.
Sveriges Radio Programm ist HEIKO-Redaktionen.
These were international broadcasts, most of whom were funded by governments, some by religious organizations. That chime sound was really cool, but what was even cooler from Radio Sweden was their little repeating tune. Here's the way it might sound in Europe in the early 70s, followed by a recording made from New York in 1968.
Sveriges Radio Utlandsprogrammet. Radio Sweden, Stockholm. Radio Schweiz, Stockholm.
That piece they play at the top of the hour actually was featured in a major top 40 hit in 1968. Listen. Anyway, those little snippets of music being repeated over and over are called interval signals, and they were used by the major international broadcasters to help people tune in to the transmission before it was going to start. On shortwave, the frequencies would change depending upon the time of day and where you were trying to reach. No one had digital tuning, so it was actually helpful to have some familiar sound or music playing for your listeners to get tuned before the program began.
Radio Sweden.
This turned out to be Radio Prague, Czechoslovakia. That was Radio Budapest, Hungary. And this... was Radio Tirana, Albania. They were communist, but not part of the Soviet bloc. They actually were aligned with China. And they used to sometimes relay Radio Peking. But you could tell when Peking was coming by way of Tirana. It just didn't propagate the same. In fact, while I was able to receive Peking via Tirana on my original small portable radio, I wasn't able to receive Peking directly until I had a half-decent shortwave receiver. Faraway places like Peking had a particular way of coming through. Another example. Did I listen to the broadcasts? Mostly not. It was obviously a form of propaganda. But I do recall once hearing in the middle of a news and commentary the following. And now for some cheerful and happy news. The Chinese government has just completed new nuclear bomb tests. Yes, I did hear that. Another place that used to come through like Peking was Tokyo. They had a really long interval signal. I'll switch between different examples of receiving it directly from Tokyo. To be more precise, that is the way East Asian places sound coming into the east coast of North America during the North American evening using the higher frequencies. You would want to use higher frequencies at that time because the higher frequencies tend to work better when there is sunlight over the area of the Earth that the signal has to pass through. So to oversimplify a bit, when you have to go over the horizon, the frequencies above 15 kHz tend to work best when there is daylight between you and what you want to receive. The middle shortwave frequencies, roughly 6 through 12 MHz, tend to work better in the nighttime. So what I just showed you is the way China and Japan came through on the higher frequencies, which worked during our early evenings because there was daylight to the west of us. But the strongest signals are those that come through on the middle frequencies during the nighttime. The Australian Broadcasting Commission, or ABC, was so aware of this that they decided to make their main broadcast to North America during our morning on what is essentially the nighttime frequencies. This worked because there was darkness to the west of us. Because Australia liked to broadcast to us in the morning on night frequencies, their signal doesn't sound like Japan and China. It sounds like this. And by the way, there's something about this arrangement of Waltzing Matilda that is just beautiful.
This is Radio Australia, the overseas service of the Australian Broadcasting Commission.
Here's an ABC sign-off. This clip shows how the ABC, trying to sound more like the BBC, would insist that its announcers not speak in a genuine Aussie male accent. The result, to me, is, quite frankly, well, the guy just sounds emasculated.
We come now to the end of this program for listeners in East Coast areas of the United States and Canada, reminding you that a further program may be heard again tomorrow from 7:14 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time on the same frequency, 11.71 megacycles, 25.62 meters, or 9.58 megacycles, 31.32 meters. At this time, the frequency of 11.71 megacycles in the 25-meter band is closing down. But those listeners tuned to 9.58 megacycles in the 31-meter band may hear a further program from our general overseas service for the next 45 minutes until this frequency closes down at 23 hours Australian Eastern Time.
This is Radio Australia, transmitting to Asia.
We heard there a frequency change within a fairly simple frequency schedule. This contrasts with Radio Moscow, which somehow used to go out of its way to use as many frequencies as possible for no particular reason.
This is the North American service of Radio Moscow, broadcasting on 17.70, 15.45, 15.42, 15.14, 12.05, 9.87, 9.76, 9.72, 9.70, 7.32, 7.18, 7.15, 7.11, and 6.11 megahertz.
There you go. And they say it with a straight face. While the programming was arguably better from the Soviet bloc than from China, that was not what interested me in them. The Soviets were great about using lots of different interval signals and constantly switching their transmitters from one station to another. They were fascinating to watch come and go, and that was my main reason for tuning in. The other broadcaster that was famous for using a lot of frequencies was the BBC World Service, but they had a good excuse because they were covering the world. They had relay stations all over the world in places like Singapore and the Caribbean. Sometimes you would hear their signal coming around the world in two different directions, and both signals would arrive at my receiver at different times, and everything they said was double-doubled. I don't think I have any tapes of that, unfortunately, but it would happen a lot. Here's the way a world service frequency joining the feed at the top of the hour would typically sound.
Greenwich Mean Time.
BBC World Service, the news, read by Chris Chaplin. Israeli troops.
Now, when you're listening to something like this, this is about as analog as it gets, folks. It's AM radio, the same as you have on your AM radio band. It's just higher frequencies that are more useful for bouncing off the ionosphere to go around the world. The variations in the reception have to do with upper atmospheric conditions, and though this is a recording of the bells, the way they are rung is with individual people in an ancient art called change ringing. There's a natural analog beauty to all of this, and in the late 1960s, that's just the way things were done. Now, in 1970, they replaced the bow bells with a more conventional interval signal, this one. This is from a children's song about the bells, which was nowhere near as good as the bells. Unfortunately, sometime after 1970, they came to their senses and went back to the bow bells interval signal.
Additional frequencies are now available for North America 9.58 and 6.11 megahertz, and for Central America and the Caribbean 9.58 megahertz. For South America, 15.07 megahertz. Our next program at 22:45, Sports Roundup, was first for the time of Big Ben.
By the way, the Big Ben chimes were not on tape or a record. They actually had a microphone in the belfry to pick those up live. You never heard Big Ben chiming the hour on the World Service, but on individual broadcasts to specific places, you often did. Here is Big Ben chiming 1 hour GMT on a broadcast to Brazil. Please excuse my 12-year-old self for the editorial comment. I didn't like it when they talked in the middle of the chime process.
Shut up. That was Big Ben, obtained from the BBC. The following is a different clock.
Wouldn't think so, but that comes from Radio Cairo in Egypt. It has the exact same notes as Big Ben in London, but you can tell the bells are different, and there's a longer pause between each four-note phrase. By the way, back in 1969, I had to reconstruct that, and I sort of cleaned it up here, so don't try to make sense out of the Morse code. Here's the three-quarter hour from Cairo. Getting back to the BBC, the World Service was broadcasting in English 24 hours a day, with a tremendous number of frequency changes happening around the clock. Here's one of their frequencies going off the air at a time when there's no other station on the frequency.
And you can hear commentary every day at 16:09 and 23:09 hours Greenwich Mean Time. listeners in Asia. BBC World Service continues now on 15.07, 11.75, 9.74, and 6.195 megahertz.
For the BBC broadcasts to specific countries in various languages beyond Europe, the interval signal they used was this. And if you're a musician, the top notes of those chords are B, B, C. Clever little ditty, but the BBC had more. For broadcasts to Europe, yes, it's the four timpani notes. Here's another recording that was worse, but responded to digital magic. So in the 1968 through 70 period, there were four legitimate BBC interval signals. Bow Bells. That's for the World Service, temporarily replaced by Oranges and Lemons in 1970. The literal BBC for transmissions to specific places. And then BBC Europe. Now, because my friends and I were oriented toward interval signals, which is a legitimate way to explore shortwave, at least for the first year or two, we would sometimes get pulled down rabbit holes. And the BBC did that to me. During the height of my shortwave interest, I would begin tuning through the international bands at approximately 5 minutes before each hour and before each half hour, stopping on anything that might possibly be an interval signal. And one of the things I kept hitting on was this. Kind of a cool-sounding little ditty. I wondered if it was an interval signal, but I always used to tune in while it was in the middle. In other words, I never heard the damn thing start. Now, we didn't have digital tuning, so this was hard to do, but finally I was able to pre-tune to the station that played that. Okay, I'm on the carrier, so we're going to hear it from the beginning now. And then they began speaking in French, which I didn't record. So the reason I could never hear the beginning of this is that it doesn't have a beginning, it just kind of starts in the middle, and it only plays once. That explains it. Turned out it was the BBC. I don't know why they had a transmission that began with a silent carrier and then cut into that music. But the music always began in the same place, seemingly in the middle. So go figure. BBC, thanks a lot. You had me going there. There was one other case where the BBC started a transmission in an odd way. This was to Hungary. Every day they would start this broadcast with the same sound effect, followed by the same piece of music, like this. Well, I'd say that's long enough for one audio program, but there's more shortwave stuff, so I'm going to do another program. There isn't just international broadcasting on shortwave, there's all sorts of weird stuff. But when I do get back to international broadcasting, I'll definitely show you the plethora of interval signals that came from the Soviet Union. If you loved interval signals, you had to listen to the Russians come and go. You never knew what they were going to do. Now here's an additional note about the Switzerland format change. I think it was in 1970 that they gave themselves a facelift. That was when they went from this to this. The watch became a chronometer, and the name of the station changed from SBC to SRI, Swiss Radio International. But they also either changed the music box or they re-recorded the music box. In any case, the music box suddenly sounded different concurrent with all these other changes. Here's the way it sounded originally. And here it is after the change. Certain notes were somehow emphasized, giving it kind of a warm, glowy feel. Here's a side-by-side comparison of old and new. Now that is kind of subtle, but I was so used to the original that to me, the new sounded like this. Right. Now, the new recording also included a lot more of the mechanical noises of the music box operating. I'll play it again, this time repeating two segments where the mechanical noises are audible. And the funny thing is that within a few years, they had gone back to the original music box sound. I don't know whether they dredged up the old recording or mic'd it correctly and re-recorded it, but what they were using in 1982 sounded exactly like what they were using in 1968. And this version has very few mechanical noises. Okay, that's it. Until program 2.